Martin, we've changed the scenery today. We've kind of had your office into the Learning Research Centre. It's had a lick of paint and everything over the time. It looks lovely.
Yeah, it does look nice. And it's a result of a problem we got posed by having too many sixth formers. So we've had to extend the sixth form block downstairs and move the library upstairs. Not ideal. It'd be nice to have the library right down in the middle of the school, but it's as you can see, really nice space for the youngsters to come in, break time, lunch time, and during lesson time as well.
I'm going to talk a bit about communication this week. There's been various threads of communication which are important to talk about, one of which is the Parents Forum, which is something I didn't know about before I came to Lipton. Just explain what that's about.
Yeah, we spend a lot of time talking to our students here. And we spoke in previous weeks, haven't we, about how strong the student parliament's becoming and how much they're guiding us and shaping us. But we get a group of parents in, just volunteers really. We try and get them in about three times a year. So we had the parent forum this week. It's quite challenging, actually. We've managed to develop a group of parents who don't just come in and nood and smile and say, yes, Mr. Brook, everything's great. They give us some pretty rigorous challenge. But it's the kind of challenge that we relish, really. So if they don't tell us, you know, what's wrong, it's very difficult to change it. So particularly this week, they gave us some challenges around communication and the way that we're getting messages across. But yeah, I mean, that's really good for us. That can only make us better. So I'm not going to tell you I enjoy it, because sometimes it can be quite challenging. But what I do enjoy is where it takes us next. So, you know, really relish it, to be honest.
Transparency, honesty, integrity, I mean, that's all got to come into play with those sort of things, else they don't work, do they?
Yeah, we could do it in a kind of plastic way, couldn't we? And we could just pick the right parents who just come in and agree, but we're not going to get any better that way. So yeah, they're really good, a really good group. They're fiercely loyal of the school, and the challenge is always constructive. They just want things to be even better, so that's fine.
It's good to meet the community, and of course Lipton, the Academy, is part of the community, and things haven't always been so smoothly, running so smoothly the last few weeks. There's been a few issues. Just tell us a bit about those and how you're dealing with that.
Okay, so over the last couple of weeks, I've had some really difficult conversations with members of the public, and some emails that you wouldn't really want to be reading. So we've worked wonders here over the last 2 years in terms of improving the behaviour and the attitudes of our students in school, almost to the point where it's not an issue for us anymore. In fact, we're talking about trying to make students a little bit lively and a bit noisy and a bit more engaged. So we know we're doing it right during the day. Unfortunately, a very small minority of our students still dressed in uniform are letting us down on the way home. And it's something I'm not prepared to ignore. I could turn a blind eye, but I'm not going to do. While ever they're wearing the uniform, as far as I'm concerned, they're representing us, and that makes me responsible. So, I would like to apologise for the behaviour of a small number of our students. It's not been good enough. But I want to assure our wider community, members of the public, that we are doing everything we can to make things better. So we've got more staff on duty outside school and further away from school than we've ever had. We've run a series of pretty hard-hitting assemblies this week, and we are appealing to the better nature of the vast majority of our students. We've asked them to be part of the solution for us. But I'm not having a small group of students let us down with the way they talk, the way they behave, on the way to and from school. So it's something that will improve, but I want to assure the community that it's something we take really seriously. So if you do see things, please continue to let me know, as difficult as it is sometimes.
That's the message. You want people to let you know what's going on, and you won't turn a blind eye to it. You will deal with it.
Yeah. I mean, the assemblies we've done, the things that we've done around staff duties, we've done as a direct result of the complaints we've had. So I don't want people to be kind of chuntering about Lipton students. Tell us, if possible, tell us who they are, tell us what year group they're in, and we'll deal with them. I've excluded two boys this week for 4 days as a direct result of information we got from members of the community.
Powerful message. Hasn't all been that sort of stuff for you this week? You've been dealing with students, or meeting with students, the heads of year and the senior students.
Yeah, so you go from one extreme to the other, don't you? Yeah. So last night, I think there were five or six staff there with 12 of our senior students who've been elected from years 11 and 12. We had a lovely meal down on the Barbican. The restaurant owner is one of our parents, so he really looked after us. Things like that are really special, aren't they? So we just sat down as a group, staff and students, had a bit of food, had a natter, had a game of pool afterwards. Lovely way to spend a Wednesday evening, and certainly a lovely contrast compared with the other stuff that I've been dealing with in the community this week.
And what do you think of the long-term effect of that, the relationship being built, the trust being built between students and staff?
Yeah, if we're going to get this Parliament and these senior students to really have an impact on the school, then they've got to not see me as their teacher and sir, and they've got to see... So I think any way that you can break down those barriers and sit down and have a bit of food and have a chat with them, I think we're going to get more from them. If we're getting it right, there's very little hierarchy there between staff and students, because they're part of something that's going to be making decisions on behalf of the school. So yeah, I think long term, I'm hoping it will have a really positive effect.
That's brilliant. The other part of what I find very interesting about school life is that it's not just the students that are willing to learn and want to learn, it's the staff as well. And we're going to bring in, you introduced.
Well, yeah, I would like to introduce our latest signing. So please take a seat, Claire.
Thank you.
Apparently, Claire Jones, our new deputy head, has asked for a rider before she's prepared to do the interview. She wanted a special chair. She wanted a new venue. She wanted three boxes of chocolates before she was prepared to talk to you. But this is what we get, I suppose. No, I want to introduce Claire. Claire's come in as deputy head. She worked at Lipson previously. And she's come in with a really specific role. I call her the last piece of the jigsaw. She's come in with a specific role to make our good teachers even better. And I'm struggling to think of a member of staff coming in who has made more of an impact in the first 6 weeks. So there's some build-up for you. So over to you.
No pressure.
Claire, just tell us. Teaching and learning, they call it, I think. Well, you tell me.
Yeah, so for us, it's all about teaching and learning and what happens every day in every single classroom in the school. And it's really important for us that our students are engaged. And Martin talked a lot about wanting to make sure that we haven't got just compliant students who are sat listening. We want students to engage, to participate, to make sure that they are being asked all the right questions, so that they can know more and they can remember more. And ultimately, so that they can speak well, they can be confident communicators, but also achieve high outcomes when they leave us as well.
And how does that, I mean, it's a massive, massive subject, but can you give a simple way of how you might encourage that? One or two examples maybe of how that works?
So one of the things that we've looked at through our coaching model is we've looked at cold calling, has been one of our main pushes that we've worked on with staff. And cold calling is all about, it's not about putting students on the spot, it's not about I'm catching you out. It's all about trying to make sure that students know that at any point they could be asked a question, so they're always on their toes. But it's done in a really warm, invitational way. So they get given a question, then they get given lots of think time so that they can formulate their answer. And if they're not sure of what the answer is, they'll have an opportunity to maybe listen to another student's correct response and then get a chance to repeat it. And it just means that participation rates in our classrooms have just gone through the roof. So you walk around the school and it's not the case where it's just five or six students with their hands up all the time. All of our students are sat ready and waiting for those questions, and the level of questioning from our teachers has just gone through the roof as well, with lots of probing questions, process questions. So if students give a response saying, well, that's really great, can you describe that in more detail, can you add on another process to that, and it's making a real clear difference in our classrooms.
You sort of touched on that. You sound very pleased with the way that your colleagues, your teaching colleagues, have picked up on what you think is the way to go forward and are bringing it in. Yeah,
they're amazing. The staff at Lipson are just phenomenal. It's not just our teaching staff; it's our support staff as well who have had to embrace these action steps that we call them, and work at ways of supporting all students to make sure that they can engage with them. And our team have just been phenomenal. So we've got 14 coaches. Who we worked as a team to coach the coaches, we called it, where we ran through all of our, we've got eight action steps that we want to our teachers to use to improve participation and engagement. And those coaches work together to make sure they're now experts, and every member of staff has a coach who comes to see them on a fortnightly basis. And they just work on one thing. Just, we call it something bite-sized, something really small that can make a difference. And then your coach comes back to see you 2 weeks later to see it in action, where hopefully you've then embedded it as a habit. And it's hard as teachers, we do have a default. And some of us have talked about ways of overcoming that default with cold calling, making sure that we're almost marking on our seating plans who we're asking questions to make sure that we're asking the whole class. And staff have just been phenomenal. And the best thing that I've seen is, beyond just the coaching model, a lot of teachers are now arranging to go and observe each other. That, right. You know, they're not coach and coachy. It's really opened up the doors. Yeah. It's opened up the doors at the school. And, you know, English teachers learning from science teachers and vice versa. They've just engaged with it so positively. We couldn't have asked for a more positive response.
And the teachers also, there's a research group which meets monthly here, where you have experts come in and impart latest information on teaching techniques. Is that all part of the same process?
Yeah, so it all runs alongside it. So it's led by Vicky Cargin, our research lead, and she's a phenomenal member of staff with an unbelievable amount of expertise in teaching and learning. So we've got a world-class range of speakers who are coming to the school, either virtually or in person. So sessions so far have included Kate Jones, who's talked to us about retrieval practice. She's a practitioner from Abu Dhabi, who has been making great inroads with her new books about retrieval. And again, that's about those questions. Retrieval is all about, for our students, making sure that they haven't just remembered last lesson, that they remember a piece of knowledge from last week, last term and last year, so they can know more, remember more. So that session was attended by over 60 staff, and they're voluntary sessions. Part of what's made coaching so fantastic is that we've taken away twilight sessions after school, where it's just all teachers sat in a hall being listened, you know, being talked to the whole time. Our development as teachers is through our coaching conversations. And then it means that attendance at research group is optional, but our staff are opting to attend because they're enriched by our professional development, and they all want to improve. And
it frightened me to death when I saw the list of contributors, because I thought it was going to cost me a fortune. But somehow Vicky's managed to get them all in for free on a goodwill gesture. So our staff have got access to a really, really high class program that's costing us nothing, which is. But the less said about that, the better.
Indeed.
Well, we could probably talk about it forever. It sounds a hugely interesting topic, and the results that we've seen already.
Most definitely.
We've got to let Martin go because
it's
on the table.
It's interesting. I met with a group of parents this week, and they told me that they quite enjoy listening to the vlogs, but they tend to have it on while they're making their tea, and they've got a glass of wine next to them, and they're making their spaghetti bolognese. So this is for you, ladies. I'm going next door now. I'm cottage pie for me for tea tonight. I'm just about to go and make it. It's a bit early in the day for a glass of wine, but I hope you've enjoyed the latest edition, and this one's for you.
That was hilarious.